What's up, everyone, and welcome to the Leeds Jitz podcast, episode 106, I think. And today we're talking about an upcoming course we're running called GBF, Gracie Barra Female Program, which is an 8-week course. It's going to be led by Coach Lauren, who's on the podcast today, along with Professor Mike and Soaps. I'm going to talk all about it today, what it is, and then I've also got at the end, there's some like end of class messages, which are generally like value type topics that we could maybe elaborate on. And I think it'll give good context of what the classes are about if we talk a little bit about that. All right. Cool. It's International Women's Day today as well.
Yeah. Woo-hoo.
Lauren.
It's almost like we planned it.
Almost.
Yeah. You didn't even know.
I did in the back of my head somewhere now because I knew that the Vanessa English seminar today was International Women's Day. All right, so GBF program. When's it start? Thanks for asking. 2nd of May.
Well, what is it? And why are we doing it?
That's a good question. So it's an 8-week, it's mirrors the GB1 curriculum. So it's not any more basic. It's not or anything like that. It's just a female-only kind of introduction into jiu-jitsu. The 8-week course mirrors the first 8 weeks of the fundamentals program we run anyway. Mm-hmm. It's not really designed to be an ongoing program that we run like all the time.
Yep.
It's meant to give people who are maybe a little bit hesitant to jump into a normal mixed class a gateway or a stepping stone into regular fundamentals training. Doesn't mean it's a watered down version of the curriculum or anything like that. You're still getting really good jiu-jitsu, but in a smaller group to start with, because we're only offering it to 16 people, with the support of a female instructor, Coach Lauren in this case. And the idea is that after those 8 weeks, you'll have the bit more confidence and you'll know what jiu-jitsu is about, and you'll have the opportunity to sign up for regular normal training, which will be running at the same time as the classes that we're going to do anyway.
So you've already built a routine around those timings in the week, so it's seamless, isn't it? You're literally the room next door. In fact, whilst you're partaking in GBF, the class next door will be on. That would be the class that you'd naturally slide over into.
Yeah.
So you'll see a lot of people, same face. You'll see how friendly the community is. I wonder as well whether this is important. I imagine it is, well, for anybody, not just women, but given there's, you know, up to 16 people in this class, and you'll see those people twice a week for 8 weeks, you are naturally going to create some relationships and some trust. And so if you're then thinking, oh, I'd like to go over, and then you know that another two of your new friends are going to go do it, you've already got three friends in the new class. So I think it's a really nice way to start to build. And I think it's worth saying why we're doing this, because there'll be some people maybe who say, well, you know, you don't do that for men, or you don't do that for other demographics. But I think we all appreciate how different this might be, and I'd be interested in your thoughts on this, but how different jiu-jitsu lands on you as a female. From the very fact that it's so tactile and you're put in positions which objectively you would never place yourself in those situations with someone you didn't know, even in a safe environment like this. And so what do you guys think in terms of, well, why don't you tell us from the beginning, were you hesitant in starting jiu-jitsu? Or did you as a person just feel it was a natural thing to do? And my second question would be, and what do you think the majority of women think when they look at jiu-jitsu?
I think it's definitely, like you said, I think when you first come into it, it seems really bizarre. And it's like, yeah, it's putting yourself in like an uncomfortable position. And when you don't really know much about it or have much technique, it can seem a bit odd. I think for me, I always wanted to roll with men and women because I think that's important, but I can appreciate that for some women, initially they might not want to do that. And I think, like you said, it's a good way of kind of introducing them to jiu-jitsu so that they can get comfortable with it, to then maybe get the confidence to want to then roll with men and women. What about you, Sams?
Yeah, I've always been comfortable with both, like with mixed training environments. It's never really, I've never really seen kind of gender as anything, but I think that that's not, certainly not the case for all women. I think that, you know, I think that being out on the streets and being in fear of your own safety is a massive thing, especially in women. And you sometimes kind of shy away from dealing with that and, like, you know, thinking about how you could actually do something to help yourself in the future and educate yourself on it. So I think that it's almost like great to bring people in and give them that education and help them do it in like a fun, sporty way, a social way. But also slowly over time, you do build confidence. And you know, if you've got fears about certain things in the outside world, you're able to kind of bring a voice to them, talk about them. I know we've done we did a workshop for people to come in, and I know I've still taken some things from that, as well as kind of the self-defense elements of the start of the lesson that are definitely kind of building that resilience in me to feel like I am safe and I'm okay, and things like that. So I imagine that it would be of interest to people to come and kind of face that, like, unknown and get comfortable with the uncomfortable and talk.
I think for you both as well, like, it might not seem like you both are fairly comfortable kind of stepping into training, but remember, you both actually had like somewhat of a stepping stone into training because your partners both trained.
Yeah.
So you already had a little gateway into training. Yeah. There's a lot of women out there, I think, that might like to do some kind of class like jiu-jitsu or some kind of thing around, you know, a positive community, growth, kind of the mental and physical challenges, self-defense stuff maybe, but don't have a gateway to it. Their kids don't train in a martial art already, or their partners don't train. Coming into a place, you know, this would be a much easier place to come to than a lot of places, but coming to what you build up a martial arts school to be in your head when you've never been to one before, without having, oh, my husband already trains, or my partner already trains, or my kids already go there, that's a big step for a lot of people, I think.
You're right. Yeah. I wouldn't have come. As no way.
A kid, I did some martial arts, and I was a sort of 11, 12 year old girl amongst a lot of like adult men. So that kind of probably makes me feel more comfortable. But that also was potentially a reason that I didn't follow through with it, as in, like, I didn't have kind of peers that I could maybe relate to. And so I think, like, you know, we've got quite a big base of females already that are training in with us. And, you know, that kind of just being together and supporting each other is really beneficial to everyone.
I don't think jiu-jitsu... Sorry, Lauren, go on. I'm going to say something.
You go first.
I was going to say, I don't think jiu-jitsu naturally fits the personality types that a majority of females would have. I don't think it does. I think it's probably the opposite of that. What I want to say to anyone listening, because we should put this out, and if anyone's listening to this you will know someone in your family or friendship circle you think would benefit from it from a female perspective. You know, you don't have to be fit and strong to do this. You don't have to be, you know, rough and tough. You don't also have to be in a really vulnerable spot or have faced violence before, although that is a great reason to come. One thing I might offer people as an idea here, particularly, you know, we talked there about maybe not having a partner who does it, maybe a single mom, maybe a single mom with a teenage daughter. You know, what an amazing role modeling behavior to do. Even, you know, even if you only did the 8 weeks and you thought, well, actually, it's not for me. But to show your children that you're the kind of person who's prepared to step out of the comfort zone is a huge lesson for them. Or maybe even you've got some friends or you want to come as a group and do it. Or you've got like a daughter who's 16 and you want to bring them to, is it 16 the minimum age?
Yeah.
Yeah. You've got a 16-year-old daughter or an 18-year-old daughter back from uni. Well, come and do it together. And, you know, I think we've got to role model those behaviours, right? And you'll have seen it in your children. Well, both your kids' daughters train. And they will see you doing it. And that will give them the confidence for it not to be weird.
I think, you know, being a parent, and I don't know if it's a female mother thing. It's very easy to put others first and to, you know, get everything else done, and you just don't carve out that time for yourself. So, you know, whereas going to a gym, having a gym membership is just so open to not going, you know, have an excuse, have something else going on. Like having, for me, the idea of having that like set time, set week, seeing the same people, it just gives people a place to be, a time to be, to make it happen and make it work. So I really hope that encourages people to say, like, I really need to carve that time out for myself, because you'll flash forward 5 years and you won't have done anything for yourself. So I think it's a great chance to get some structure in your week for yourself, time for yourself.
I think our community plays like a big role in it though, because for me, obviously, like, you know, that I've had a history of like sexual assault and stuff. And I was reflecting on the podcast that I did when I spoke about it, and like reading my Brené Brown book on vulnerability and stuff. And the fact that I was able to be vulnerable on a podcast with you two and trust you, like, I think says a lot about the community. Like, I've never really spoke about it, never spoke about it publicly. And then I decided to speak about it with two males that I'd not known that long. So I think, and that's trust. I trusted you guys to be vulnerable and share my story. And I think that says a lot about our community and the males here. So I think for me, it's kind of shown me that, like I said, you know, there is good men, and that you can roll with men and women, and we're all kind of the same community. And I think me and you have spoke quite a bit, haven't we, about all sorts. But I think one of the things as well is, like, I always thought that I was somebody that didn't need a community. I used to sort of view myself as quite a independent person and don't really need anyone. And I think that's probably come from like my childhood. We were talking, weren't we, about behaviors that you develop, and that I've kind of brought that into my adult life, and it doesn't really serve me anymore. If anything, it kind of has adverse effects. And I think to come here and realize that I do need that community, and I do need that connectedness to people, and I think everybody does. And I think the power that gives you, like, for me, it's allowed me to sort of face things, revisit my trauma in, like we were saying, in a moderate, controlled way that's helped me become more resilient. But I wouldn't be able to do that without the community, because you need people to be able to do that.
Can I offer something on that point about community as well? For you specifically, and I said something to you last week about this, about how proud I was of your growth as a person because of what you've been through. I think what the community also does is give you a slice of humanity, and it gives you an opportunity to see that not everyone's a dickhead. So, you know, you can come into, because I remember the first time, or the first few times perhaps you'd had, let's say, a slightly more physical role with a guy, it would knock you back and you'd be like, oh my God, what's this? Quite naturally. But now you don't feel that. And I wonder whether or not, well, I wonder how important that is for some women to come and do this and see that they can be safe around strange men, strangers that are men. Not strange men, we don't have strange men. because again, to your point, so it's like out in the real world, like out in, when you're on your own out there, for some people, everyone will be a threat and an unknown. And actually getting that trust that, you know, this big dude on a dark night in a car park when I'm bringing my shopping home, my kids, actually might not be a bad guy.
Yeah.
And it gives you that little bit more confidence to stand tall, right? I think that's a huge part of it. And there's nothing more, there's nothing makes me or T more proud than to see our students develop. I wouldn't say especially women, but I think there's a slightly different lens that we shine on our female students. We know how difficult it is. We know how difficult it is for blokes to come in here. We know how difficult it is for ex-professional rugby players to come in here and see them trembling on the first class. Never mind, you know, I say this with absolute respect, but a single mom who weighs 8 stone coming in here, like that is a huge step. But I think by taking that one step and coming into an environment which hopefully you've seen from this podcast is supportive with people who care about you, it's going to just help you grow and help you move to that next level in everything. Even whether it's standing up and having a direct conversation with your husband about something you're not happy about, or your boss, or your your kid's teacher, like it's going to enable you to have that little bit extra self-confidence, and that's massive.
I think that's another thing I was going to say, and me and you spoke about it, aren't we, is that it does, it's like, and we've all spoke about it loads, you transfer it through your life then, so it makes you want to be, like for me, it's made me way more confident, it's made me want to be more vulnerable, like it's just everything that I've learned on the mat I've kind of taken into my life. But I think as well, like we had a very in-depth podcast on self-defense, didn't we? And we touched on it there. But I think for women, like we were saying, you know, if you're gonna, you know, statistically, if you're gonna be attacked or in a confrontation, it's gonna be grabbing, choking, you're gonna be on the floor. Like you said, it's gonna be somebody in between your legs probably. So the things that you learn on the mat are really important life skills
savers.
And it's like, I always think, if I'd have known jiu-jitsu, would my situation have been different? I don't know, but I feel like now I feel way more confident when I'm out and about. I feel like we were saying, the fact that you're kind of constantly putting yourself in stressful situations and that's building your resilience for your stress response, I do feel like you'd be able to think more clearly and be different situations. So I just think, yeah, it's a,
we talk
so
about
many,
like that. The more you train, the more calm you feel, and as you progress, like you've been there a few months, you can just see everybody kind of approaching their specific training with a sense of calmness, and I think that shows kind of growth, doesn't it, of dealing with the stress, etc. I also wanted to bring up the point that I think a lot of people, both male and female, kind of have this thing that they need to have done something before they come here, as in they need to have like got fitter, or you know, there's prerequisites that they feel they put on themselves. Just come in and be like your most vulnerable self. Just be yourself wherever you're at. If you've not left your kids for 6 months and you haven't done anything for yourself, or you don't feel like you've got any kind of knowledge, or you don't need any of that, just come in as a blank canvas. And you know, that's our role to help get you off your feet. But I guess what I'm saying is, don't like leave it and wait because you need to do something before you come down. Just throw yourself in, and there's so much for you to take and build on.
I mean, we all should have been doing this stuff from the age of five, right?
Yeah.
But they say, don't, the best time to plant a tree is 20 years ago. The next best time is today. So like, don't wait. You know what you're waiting for? I think if you're thinking about it, or you've seen this or heard about it, and you're thinking, the answer should be yes, because actually, you don't know when you might need this stuff. I think it's worth saying, what this is not going to give you is some superpowers in 8 weeks. It's not going to make you a self-defense expert in 8 weeks. But I think we talked about this because we've had two separate individual experiences of trauma. So you've had sexual assault trauma, and I had trauma out in the ocean. And what happens is you kind of float out of your body and see yourself in the third person. And that certainly happened to me. We talked about this the other day.
Like disassociation.
You disassociate from the trauma and the fear and what you're going through. And I remember like actually thinking I was seeing myself doing the road rather than doing the road. What this will give you is a little bit of a buffer between when that starts to happen. I think as your confidence and the exposure to that stimuli that we provide you in that safe environment, that will just delay that response. So instead of automatically checking out when something bad happens, like a guy comes up to you in the street and you go, and you're gone, you're just maybe 10 seconds, 5 seconds, that might be enough. You know, it might be enough for you just to, whoa, and that could really save you. So it won't give you superpowers, but what it will do is give you a better chance at dealing with whatever situation you're faced with in a better way for you.
I know for like me, I know maybe not everyone's the same, but when I started, I used to feel really like panicky when I was like on bottom, or if I were being smothered, and I can remember feeling like I was gonna have like a panic attack, or I'd really struggle with my breathing, and that used to like really bother me. Whereas now, I mean, I still have my moments, but now I feel like I can think and be calm in that position. So it's had that in itself is like a massive thing. Like you were saying, you can,
it's that clarity, isn't it? It's not foggy anymore. It's just you can think, and connect.
What kind of things to you are going to be doing in these classes? Like, can you talk about the structure of it? Like, how does it work when you come in?
Well, it mirrors the fundamentals program already. I just wanted to say that on kind of off some of our previous points, though, like the self-defense aspects of it are great. And if that's what gets you in the door to train, fantastic. But like from a lot of the research GB has done, the main reason women train or continue to train isn't because they feel like it's going to give them more self-defense. Mm. It's because it's really fun. They feel like it's part of their lifestyle, and it's physically and mentally very stimulating and challenging for them. So don't feel like this is some kind of strict self-defense type course where you're gonna, you just come in because you've got to develop these skills so you feel safer down the street. Like, you're gonna come in, you're gonna love it. It's gonna be part of your lifestyle. You're gonna have a great time. You're gonna meet a great bunch of people.
Yeah.
And it's gonna feel like whatever hobbies you've had in the past that you've really enjoyed and maybe fell out of, it's gonna be that whole experience again where you kind of start to fall in love with the sport and have that fun thing. And that's kind of the extra powers martial arts with is those extra things we were saying, like that confidence, like you might not necessarily get if you go, well, I'm not sure what women really do as adults in terms of like individual / team sports, but if you're a guy, you probably go like, my brother played like five-a-side football and stuff like that. That's great, but it's not, doesn't really compare to what you get off of the mats. You're not developing the same kind of things because the unique thing about what we do here, it's a, you're in a team, but it's also super individual. Whereas like in football, I feel like, yeah, there's individual moments, but ultimately like you fail or succeed as a team. Whereas here in the mats, your team will look after you and get all those benefits, but ultimately you fail or succeed as an individual. So there's all these aspects of growth that you might not get playing hockey or going dancing or yoga or other kind of popular sporting activities for adults. To answer your question though, structure of the thing, just the same as we usually run. So for people that don't know, you'll come in, we're gonna do one self-defense type technique. We'll do two more techniques that are more around sport and jiu-jitsu. And obviously all the kind of things will get explained to you, like what is the guard and why do we need to pass the guard and what is a submission and why is it our aim kind of thing. So all that will get explained. And then you can do some specific training, which is where we'll try and put into practice the things we've learned in that class against a resisting opponent, your people in the class with you. And then finish up the class, end of class messages, and that's it.
We start with like the same warm-up every time, don't we? So again, to Service's point, I imagine one of the big things for people starting any new sport or any new physical pursuit is that they feel they're not quite ready to take that step because they need to do something before they go. What, you know, what is amazing about our GB1 or our GBF warm-up is it's the same every single week. So, you know, maybe on week one you can't get through the warm-up without stopping. That's all right. Maybe next week you do one more rep. Maybe by the end of the 8 weeks you can do the whole thing without getting out of breath. Like, that in itself is a huge marker of your development. So we do all that, don't we? We have a cool down at the end so we can deregulate and we can just think a little bit about what we've been doing. And I believe it's a really, really well put together hour. It's an hour. You know, so that's the other thing. It's like, you've got to see this as an investment in yourself. Like, you can give yourself 2 hours a week. If you're a busy female out there working or a mom or both or whatever, or someone perhaps who hasn't got any of that and is wanting to find something for themselves, you can give yourself 2 hours a week. You deserve 2 hours a week. That's it.
I came, so I've got a 14-week-old at home and I had an hour away from her to come to class. I think it was last week. And it was amazing. And I just loved being so present in the moment and just that escapism was incredible. But when I came away from it and I looked at the time, I thought, oh my goodness, it's 1 o'clock. I've only been away from her for an hour. It felt like five. It felt like I had half a day away and I went and picked her up and it just elevated my mood, my energy, everything. And I just couldn't believe how much value I took from that small snippet of time. So you just don't realize that you just don't do things for yourself or you haven't carved that time out. But you know, if I can do it with a very young baby, then, you know, you've got to try and find a way, use friends. I use friends a lot to help with them, you know, support. You know, would you like to cuddle or walk my baby around the park for an hour? Like people are willing to help, but you've got to ask sometimes and you've got to, you know, say that this is really important to me.
It's easy to find an excuse, isn't it? Especially when you don't know the value of something. So I would like to kind of make it an analogy to like money. So like, you don't, ultimately these people who will hopefully do this course, they don't, never done jiu-jitsu before. It's not open to like existing members. So they don't know how valuable jiu-jitsu could be or might be for them. So if I asked you to like trade your time spending jiu-jitsu and let's extrapolate all the kind of things you've got from that, like the community, like you wouldn't have met your friends that you've got now from jiu-jitsu and however your life would be if you never walked in or heard about GBRL. How much money would you trade that for? It's like, you're getting pretty priceless to extremely high, like millions, if not billions, kind of thing. So you don't know what the value is going to be. So if it's like, oh, you know, Wednesday night at 6 p.m. is kind of inconvenient. I don't really get home until I'm going to be rushing around. Probably can't do it. It might be that you might just want to say to your boss for 2 months, right, I need to leave early in these days. Mm-hmm. Like, that might be a massive thing for you to try and say that to someone, but you ultimately don't understand how valuable it might be for you to miss out on this course, or how valuable it could be for the next 10, 30 years of your life, that this was the catalyst and this was the thing that got you into jiu-jitsu.
Have we set a price for it yet?
Yeah, it's £99. It includes a uniform to use for the duration of the course. If you would then like to continue on with jiu-jitsu, keep that uniform completely free. If not, no problem. Just hand it back to us and we will recycle it.
So if you did... Right, okay. I own this gap. I didn't know the price. It's a great... So, and this is not a sales pitch, by the way, but so if you did the 8-week course, you kept the uniform, you're basically getting it for free.
Mm-hmm.
The whole course for free. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, there's no excuses now, guys. Ladies. Is there? It's literally is.
If you think you're buying a gi, you're getting 8 weeks worth of tuition.
Yeah, it's free, isn't it?
That's mad.
I love this. I think it's a really nice initiative for us to do. I think it's great that Gracie Baja globally are launching this. This is not just GBRL's thing. This is something that you'll find in all of the premium academies around the world, of which we're proud to be one. So it's a really well put together thing. They did a lot of research on this. They made sure it was right. It's not something that we've just concocted in ourselves over the last few weeks. I'm really excited to do it. What I'd like to encourage any of our members, and I'll say this again, who are listening to this, who believe that they know someone who could benefit, you've got to share it.
Mm-hmm.
You've got to send this podcast and say, you know, it's 45 minutes, give it a listen.
Mm-hmm.
I'm certainly going to do that today. We should all be sharing it on our socials. Everyone else should be as well. Mm-hmm. What I'd love to have is a waiting list. For GBF.
Where there's
50, 100 ladies who really want to do it, but it's going to be exclusive, right? We're capping it at 16 to keep the quality high, so you've got to get in early and get signed up.
What's our like age range here? Just to give people, I'm thinking of some of my friends that would really benefit that are, you know, in their 50s and maybe thinking like, oh, I don't know, I'm just thinking of barriers to people coming in, I suppose, and what's our age range on the mats? It's very vast, isn't it?
We certainly have members that have trained here in their 60s. And I mean, we have, you know, kids that have come up from juniors and team program that are, you know, 15, 16.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, you can tailor the experience, you know, a good instructor can tailor an experience for the student. So, you know, if you're 22 and looking to get after it like a competitor, I'm not going to put you with the 44-year-old who just wants to get moving a little bit.
Hang on, I'm 42. not that old.
You might be the 20-year-old who just wants to take it steady. I feel like you can get away with a minimum level of physicality. I know you talk a lot about like good movement and stuff, but you can, if you're not someone that does loads, you can still move and learn, and it doesn't have to be super dynamic, does it? It can be the, you know, like the subtle things.
So I've got a specific question for you, personal one. So you've just had a baby. So I know that when my wife had our two kids, it changed her body, and she wasn't able to do some of the things, like running, for instance, was a different experience for her.
Mm-hmm.
What's it been like for you? And do you foresee any, you know, what if there's ladies out there who've had kids, the body's not quite the same, or they've got injuries, what's it like?
Okay, a few things. I think that, you know, the uniform that you get to wear here is very forgiving. It's very comfortable. You don't feel like, I don't know, if you go to the gym, sometimes you feel like, oh, I need to wear like this vest and this leggings. Like, I feel like from just getting onto the mats, like I felt very comfortable. Obviously, your body goes through change with pregnancy. I mean, I trained up to 37 weeks pregnant, so I was obviously having to wear that uniform and move around having a baby in there as well. And I still felt like I'd look in the mirror some days and think, oh, I feel a bit silly like doing this, but I knew that for me, the value value was way, way more than like how I looked. But I think for some females, and I've had this before, you've had that kind of self-consciousness. So I think that's a great thing that hasn't been something that's ever stopped me from getting on the mats. I know that for me, recovering from having baby birth, etc., there's some, you know, strength internal work that, you know, you kind of need to do, working on those core strength elements. But there's things like in the warm-up, I can't do the break falls properly yet. Mm-hmm. And there'll be other people that maybe for another reason can't do something, but I just, I've done my own adaptive version, and nobody ever even notices or looks on. And in terms of training, like I was someone that was particularly mobile, I would say, prior to having a child, and learning to train around being pregnant was really interesting for me. And I think I said a few times, I feel like someone that's now immobile, and I know how that feels to people, and having to adapt techniques to make it work for me. I don't know if that answers your question. Is there an element of it?
Yeah, I think, you know, it does, because I think that would be one barrier to entry for a lady. Certainly thinking about how Sarah, my wife, was going back to running, she had to adapt perhaps the volume that she did, or the way she trained. Yeah. To accommodate the fact that her body felt different. I think it's worth just a separate topic, but talking about the facilities a bit and what you can expect from this place. So an amazing floor plate here, like the best mats in the world. So if you fall over in jiu-jitsu, it's not like falling onto your kitchen floor. You're going to fall onto the best mats in the world. We've got areas to chill out. If you wanted to bring your kids, and we've got books, we've got a library, we've got things to colour in, we've got a TV. So, you know, you could bring your kids along and they could hang out in this area or in the cafe next door while you did your training. They could watch you through the window. They could watch you on CCTV in that back room training. That's amazing. Grab a coffee. You've got drinks and snacks for the kids as well. In the changing rooms, it's probably, I mean, I would say one of the nicest looking Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu female changing rooms in the world. I've never been like it.
Hairdryer station. Sanitary
products. Like, you know, we think we've covered it all when it comes to, you know, eliminating all those barriers to entry. You're not going to come into a spit. This is not your typical martial. We used to say this. This is our strong line. We're not your typical martial arts academy. This is not a dirty, freezing cold, dusty place. This is hopefully a home from home where you feel super comfortable and you're able to, you know, just focus on being you on the mat.
And I've really been grateful for training partners, so people that you're training with, and the coaches, just, you know, where I've needed to adapt things, how open they've been to like noticing and suggesting and kind of supporting me through that. I've found that to be really beneficial, because you don't necessarily have that knowledge yourself. You know, I haven't done this sport while being pregnant, so I really needed kind of support on that journey and post baby. And I just think, you know, that there's people here that have the knowledge that can help you and guide you, and that's been really, really helpful for me and kind of my recovery. So, you know, I'm thinking if you're quite soon after having a baby, that I feel like you can still do so much, almost everything. And the coaches here are here and willing and ready and knowledgeable enough to help and support you in that. So
and there's a really nice, we have, you know, if you become a member of GBRL, we have, you know, WhatsApp groups and communication groups for all different programs. And there's a separate one for ladies too, right? Mm-hmm. Which, I mean, we're not in. So what's that like? Is that...
Yeah, there's 30 of us in there.
Kind of like also 30 women in train. Yeah. So, and that's a nice community in of itself, right? Mm-hmm. To talk and ask questions. And,
absolutely.
You know, and any ladies coming, you've got, you know, two, you know, women here role modeling that who've trained for years now, who I would say have got, you know, a really good level of jiu-jitsu. So any questions in the future, you've got friends who you'll be able to ask them.
Yeah.
And that, like, almost kind of ready-made community.
Yeah,
and for just some, to step straight into.
Yeah, for some people that I mean, we've talked about being happy training in a mixed environment, and obviously our classes are mixed, but if you really, like, you do kind of find someone on the course that you really gel with, you can kind of come to class together.
Yeah.
Not necessarily be partnered together, but it's just having that arrangement. Yeah. It's having that place and time to be somewhere and to see someone, and people will arrive early to class, you know, even just 10 minutes, just to have that catch up, have that chat before or after training. So I think it's been great for that. For some people, they've really reached out and said like, oh, who's doing this type of training?
Yeah, yeah.
Or, you know, if you are someone that's a competitor, training with females, if you're going to compete, is it feels different.
Yeah.
I think it's quite useful to be able to kind of like, I know if you're kind of got a comp coming up, I'm conscious like, oh, can I be available to help uh-huh. train and drill with you, etc. So we've got people in that group of all kind of age ranges and kind of competitors, non-competitors. So I think it's just a great place that we've got, and we're starting to have some open mat sessions which are female only, which is really mainly for like a social, get those people together, get people that maybe have joined at different points mm-hmm. together to make those connections, in case, because our timetable is so comprehensive, we've got a lot of classes on, you might miss people, you might not see each other, so mm-hmm. it's just finding those links, finding the joining up the dots basically mm-hmm. to make sure. But I mean, you know, the 30 ladies we've got on there, that's like a full-size class at school, and like when I was saying earlier about being in a martial art where I was like the only female and young, to think that there's just like, you know, that many adult mm-hmm. females, it's just incredible. And you know, I don't even know how many kids we've got, but as the kids have moved up, so we've got a recent teen that's come up into the adults class, like she's joined into that group mm-hmm. and she's now mixing with you know, our other ladies and things. So right. it's providing support at all ends of the spectrum, really.
Definitely.
Have we got time for me to ask Lauren how she's feeling about leading this class for the first time? I think it's worth saying that you've not been a coach, not been a lead coach for, you've been an assistant coach in the kids program for a long time, but you've not led your own classes. How's that landing?
I'm excited about it. I think maybe a few years ago, I probably wouldn't have done it. I think it's a weird one, because like when I was younger, like I did a lot of like Johnny always laughs at me. I used to do like public speaking for like a competition. Like it was like, you used to like do memorized prose like Wharfdale Festival and stuff. And I did theatre and dance and singing and all that kind of stuff. So that never used to bother me. And then I think there was like, I don't know, then I just changed and I became really kind of like not confident, and think I used to have a thing with like people judging me and not being good enough and all that kind of stuff. So I just kind of shut that part of my life down and never revisited any of that. So then to come here, I think coming here and building up my confidence has made me think, oh yeah, you know, you can do this. So yeah, no, I'm excited about it. I think it's a really good thing. And I think like I said, I think from what it's done for my life and all the things we've talked about, I just feel like I want more people to experience that, especially women, because I just think it's just so valuable. And
there'll be someone sat at home that you know, listens to this, comes down and ends up being someone on our coaching team in the future. Like, you didn't anticipate being a coach, you came for your own fun, and you've developed so much from being here that you're now, you know, you've got the knowledge because you've learned that through that, but how much it's developed you as a person now gives you the confidence to be able to do that. Like, you're not a teacher by trade, so it's, and you know, a lot of our coaches then maybe haven't had experience in that mm-hmm. before, but the combination of the knowledge they're gaining and just the support and that build up of confidence, and like, yeah, like you're saying about being vulnerable and not judging yourself, like not being critical of, you know, the first session you might not think was 100% your best effort, mm-hmm. but if your authentic self, that's what these women, that's what people want you to be.
Yeah.
We're just all vulnerable together and we just support each other.
Yeah.
Your point there, I like to say, it's about, you know, you could be the next kind of coach here kind of thing. I'm sure Mike, when you introduced me to Jiu-Jitsu back in 2015, didn't think we'd have an academy together. And equally, when I partnered with Frost.
Definitely not. Yeah. I was picking you up and driving to Jiu-Jitsu.
I partnered with Frosty in his trial class. I wasn't thinking this guy's going to be a Jiu-Jitsu coach.
Yeah. But like, I nearly gave it all up, didn't I? Like, mm-hmm. when we're at not last
18
months.
Yeah, I remember those 2 hour phone calls over New Year.
And I was just like, oh, it's not for me. Like, I can't be asked.
But you talk about it as a bit of a roller coaster. Like, you have.
Yeah.
And that's why it's not. That's why about things like having this 8 weeks set in stone, it's not. It's somewhere to be every week. So if you're having a week where you're tired or you're like, oh, I'm not. You know, you love it 1 week and then you're like a bit unsure. It kind of keeps you coming back and you kind of got to push through those lows because I'm sure we've all had them in training as well as in other aspects of life.
Yeah, it wasn't that you couldn't be asked. It was really difficult
for you.
And everyone has that wobble. And I think I'll just, perhaps we'll end on this before we move on to yours, T, but don't also listen to this and think, oh my God, I've got to sign up for this program and then all of a sudden I have to do jiu-jitsu for the rest of my life. Like, you don't. No. You might only do it for 8 weeks and experience it. That might be enough for you.
Yeah.
But you might fall in love with it. Mm-hmm. And unless you do it, you won't know.
No.
I think we'll start wrapping up. Funnily enough, I haven't told these guys the mindset messages for the end of the class.
No.
I don't think you'd have seen them yet. So we've actually covered pretty much all of them. No. We've got, one of them was like, first week is welcome and the purpose of the 8-week program. Kind of covered that. GB values and jiu-jitsu, how jiu-jitsu can help you. Finding ways to celebrate your progress. So that's things like, you know, if you get tapped out 3 times, and then you, next time you get tapped out 2 times, that's still great progress in jiu-jitsu.
What does tapping out mean, just for those that maybe watch?
If you get submitted, so to the point where you want whatever your partner's doing to you to stop, that would be a submission, and you would tap to let them know that you'd like them to stop. Or say the word tap. Doing it for yourself. So we talked about that, like, you know, making some time for yourself and not feeling like, you know, like you're always having to do things for other people, making sure it's just for you. Communicate well with your partner. Gender not having a bearing on your ability to learn jiu-jitsu. You know, it's not just for big, strong guys that are hitting the gym. You know, it's for jiu-jitsu for everyone. It's literally the tagline for Gracie Baja. Becoming more physically confident and focusing on what your body can do, not like what things you're struggling with. And then just like a closing message for the 8 weeks.
Do you think we could end, T, by just being really clear on, again, how much it costs, what it is, when it's starting, if we're going to run this multiple times a year, like, you know, what are the real kind of things that people need to take away if they're considering this?
So let's say you've listened to this and you're keen to sign up. There'll be a link in the bio. If you are listening to it on the week of release, we're going to do a pre kind of sale for existing members or the families of existing members. So if you're a mum of one of the kids that train here, or you're the wife or the partner or the sister of one of the adult members kind of thing, then you'll have first dibs on one of these 16 places.
But it's not for existing members though, is it?
But if you're an existing female student, this course isn't for you. So please don't sign up for it, because I'll have to action refunds and things like that. And then it'll go to the wider public at some point next week. So if it's not sold out by then you will have an opportunity to jump on. The course is £99. Again, you'll get a uniform included in that. It starts Wednesday, the 2nd of May, 2nd or 3rd of May, can't remember, whichever that Wednesday is, at 6 p.m. will be the Wednesday classes. Fridays will be the next class of the week, which will be at 7 p.m. And it'll run to the 23rd of June.
And after this, are we going to run another?
I'd very much like to. We'll see what the take-up is, but we're kind of thinking it'll sell out pretty quickly, to be honest. Just with what the interest we've had already and the very limited places, I think it'll be a good hit, and in which case I think maybe one after summer would be good, something like that.
Yeah, I mean, if it's anything like the free women's self-defense seminars we've done in the past, they sell up very quickly, and people are on waiting lists. So if you are considering it, I'd get in there pretty quick.
And when you look at like cost per class, plus the uniform is the only thing you need in jiu-jitsu, you don't need any other kit. Like, it's just, it's phenomenal, really, that they're going to get that.
All right. Well, thank you very much for everyone's time.
Thanks, ladies. Thanks, Tate.
And we'll see you guys next week.